Hello everyone, today we will study about classification of phylum Platyhelminthes. The phylum Platyhelminthes includes organism consisting about 50,000 of species, and they are classified or divided into three classes. The class 1, Turbellaria, that includes ciliated flatworms which are generally free living. Then second class is Trematoda, which are non-ciliated parasitic flatworms or flukes. And third one is the Cystoda, which are all endoparasitic flatworms or tapeworm. Okay, so we'll begin with the class 1, that is class 1, Turbellaria. They are almost this Turbellaria example is Planaria. Or it is also called as a planarians, and the meaning of Turbellaria is that in a Latin it is called turbella is a little string. Okay, so that's why it is called as a Turbellaria. Okay, turbella means little string in a Latin word. Okay, so they are basically free living, but they are free living and mostly bottom dwelling aquatic forms. That is, they are mostly found in the fresh water. Some are also marine, a few are even terrestrial. Okay, they have a flattened, slender, ribbon like or leaf like bodies. And they rely on a diffusion for much exchange of gases, nutrients and the waste. Okay, often they are brightly colored, while some marine forms have a warning like coloration. Okay, means dark colored. Okay, and they are free living. Some organism can be parasitic form or commensal form. Okay, what do you mean by commensal and the parasitic? In commensal, what happened, there is association between the two organism, in which one organism is benefited whereas other organism get no benefit, neither it get harm. Okay, that is the meaning of commensal. Okay, whereas parasitic, what happened in parasite is the association between the two organism, in which one organism is getting benefited while the other organism is harmed. Okay, so this is the difference between commensal and parasitic form. Okay, so again we'll revise. That is, commensal form is the association between the two organism, in which one organism is benefited while the other organism nor it benefited nor it get harm. Okay, whereas in parasite form, what happens, the one organism depends or is benefited while the other organism is getting harm. Okay, that is a difference between commensalism. Another next point is they have ciliated, unsegmented cell that are here in a Turbellaria. The epidermis, that is the body covering, is epidermis and is ciliated. Okay, and the body is unsegmented. They contain a mucus cell which secrete a mucus trail, and this end is used by cilia to glide on it, like that is and it contains rebetides that are rebetides is a is in the that is it is a chemical like, and it is discharged into the water and it swell and form a protective mucus, okay, mucus sheet around the body, and may also release a toxin to subdue its prey or escape from the predator. Okay, that is the function of the rebetides. Rebetides are also secreted by the mucus cells, and that is discharged into the water, and that gets well, and that forms a protective mucus sheet around around this organism, that is a Turbellarian organism, and it helps it secretes toxins, and it helps in a subdue of the prey and escape from the predator. Okay, then the next point is they are carnivorous, that is they feed on small crustacea, nematodes, rotifers, insect, etc. Okay, and they show incomplete digestive system, that is the tract is presence of mouth, and have some have more than one mouth or more than one pharynx, but no anus. Okay, they can detect food at a distance by chemoreceptors. So they have a presence of chemoreceptor. What is chemoreceptor? Chemo means chemical, and receptors are the receptor where the stimulus gets bind. Okay, ligand comes and the stimulus get binds. Okay, due to the stimulus in the environment, they can these chemoreceptors detect the chemical concentration of the of its surrounding. Okay, with the help of this chemoreceptor, they detect food also. Okay, this they entangle their prey in the mucus. Okay, then wraps its body around the prey, and some marine flatworms prey on the molluscans using a neurotoxin that is produced by the symbiotic bacteria. When they engulf the whole animal or cover the opening of its shell, then produce a toxin to kill it. Okay. In this, the in the Turbellaria, the pharynx consists of muscular throat-like tube. Okay, that extend prehensile proboscis to get a prey, and secretes enzyme to help pre-digest the prey. This sucks up bite of the prey, and in intestine again there is an enzyme is secreted which is further digest the prey. Okay, the, even the phagocytic cells in a gastrodermis take up bits of bites of the pieces of the prey and complete the digestion intracellular. So they show extracellular digestion also plus intracellular digestion also, that is with the help of the neurotoxin, the first the prey is digested, or it is with digested, and then it is in the intestine. The other enzymes are secreted that further digest the prey, and even the, some gastrodermis cells are present that phagocytes. So the pieces of the prey, and where the complete digestion takes place, that is intracellularly. Okay, then comes the nervous system. The nervous system and the senses, they have a distinct head with the cephalic ganglia, then the pair of ventral nerve cords connected by the lateral like interconnections. They also have a sense organs that are concentrated on a head, that is a vision, for the vision, smell, touch and taste. Okay, then the paired sense organs allow the brain to for the discern the direction of the stimulus. Okay, they also have a two eye spots, that is a oculi, that cannot form a image but only detect the light. Okay, then it also have a auricles that contain tactile cells, and the tactile cells are also distributed over the body surface. Then auricles also contain a chemoreceptors. Okay, and some Turbellaria have a stetocyst for reacting to the gravity. Okay, then comes the next point is excretory system. Excretory system consists of protonephridia with the flame cells in a fresh water forms. This is mainly a way to get rid of excess water. Okay, but the the excretion of the metabolic waste is take carried out by the body wall. Okay, in a and this is reduced or absent in the marine forms. Okay, then next point is reproduction. Reproduction is either asexual or sexual. Okay, in a asexual, there is a regeneration. In a turbellarians have a considerable power of regeneration, that is, they can replace its lost part. Also, to recover from the long food shortage, this regeneration is help. Okay, some can survive for months by self digesting up to 90% of their body. It's also that is early researchers also reported learning by cannibalism. Okay, it is thought that the planarian to run a maze cut in a half and allow to regenerate, but the new worms learn the maze quicker. That is as a okay. So next part next is next asexual reproduction is by transverse fission, okay, in which a pinch in half, that is an anterior end splits splits from the posterior end, and they also in sometimes they also produces a chain of zooids, okay, that is superficially resembles to segmentation, that is in transverse fusion. Then the in fragmentation, what happens when there is like unfavorable environment, for example in a some land planarians, they break up into dozens of blobs of slime, okay, and in a few hours each piece will become a new worm, okay, that is in fragmentation. Whereas in a sexual reproduction, what happens, they are mostly monoecious or hermaphrodites, that is both male and female gametes are present in an organism. So during breeding season, each individual develop both male and female organs, and there are cross fertilization, not a self fertilization take place. Cross fertilization means one organism will during breeding season will form only male gametes only, and another organism will produce a female gametes, that is a ovary, whereas male has a testis, okay, there are sperms, okay. So there is only cross fertilization takes place, not a self fertilization, okay. Some with the internal fertilization, that is with vaginas and the penis, usually open through a common genital pore. In some monoecious flatworms, mating ritual resembles a fight, okay, where the male organ consists of two dagger-like penises, and during mating, two flatworms' penis fans, which trying to get penis in the genital pores of the other. Okay, so some are without vagina or genital pore, use hypodermic impregnation. Generally, the fertilized egg is in this the sexual fertilization, they show there is there is no formation of larval stage, while fertilized egg is enclosed in a cocoon which is attached by a stalk to underside of the stones or the plants, and most have no larval stage, whereas the embryo directly emerges as a juveniles that grow into the adult form. In a few, very few marine species, they produce planula like lava called as a Müller's lava, and they have a ciliated ball of cells. Okay, the examples of this class Turbellarians are Terricola, then Planaria. Next class is Trematoda. Trematoda means trematode in a Greek, trematodes means having pores. Okay, so they are basically ectoparasite or endoparasite. That is, ectoparasites are the parasite which are found on the surface of the body. Okay, whereas endoparasite that resides inside the body of the host. Okay. They are leaf-like body shape, that is a like fluke, dorsoventrally flattened. They have a two suckers. That suckers will come next. Next point is body wall is without epidermis and the cilia, and it is undivided and covered with the cuticles. What is the function of cuticle? This cuticle is a flexible and it protects from the host digestive enzyme. As they are endoparasites, there is presence of the cuticle which protects the this trematoda from the host digestive enzyme. Okay, that is a function of cuticle. They have a well-developed suckers, one around the mouth and the other further down on the body. In an adult and a larvae, inhibit a wide variety of sites of hosts. That is, they are found in the digestive tract, respiratory tract, circulatory system, urinary system, and reproductive system. These flukes tend to inflict greater harm to their host than as compared to cystoda, the next class of the platyhelminthes. Okay. This fluke can be found in the veins of the intestine, bladder, bile ducts, and lungs. In a high numbers, they can cause blockage and damage to the host. Okay, they feed aggressively on the body fluid and can clog ducts and triggers gallstones and excessive enlargement of the liver. Okay. Next point is digestion. In a like turbellaria, they have well developed but incomplete digestive system. Okay, tract, but without mouth, but with the mouth at the anterior end, gut usually divided into two branches. Some dissolved nutrients can also be absorbed directly through the skin. Okay. Then the excretory system and the nervous system is similar to the planarians. That is, in planarian, what happens? They have a presence of protonephridia with the flame cells, and in nervous system, they have a well developed cephalic distinct head is there with the cephalic ganglia. Then the they have well this all the sense organ are restricted to the cephalic part, that is at the head, and they have a this ventral nerve cord connected by a ladder like interconnections. Okay, then it they also have a chemoreceptors which helps enough to detect the chemical concentration of its environment. Okay, next point is reproduction. Reproduction in class Trematoda is like sexual type of reproduction. That is, they are monoecious and capable of self-fertilization. Okay, but as compared to turbellarians, they are monoecious, but they shows a cross fertilization. But here, they are monoecious, but self fertilization is observed. Okay, in Trematoda, typically have a complex life cycle. One or more larvae occurring in intermediate host and adults in a definitive host. Okay. Adults are typically parasites of a fish or other vertebrates. So, 1 to 5 larvae occur in an intermediate host, usually a mollusk. Okay. There is also a polyembryony occurs. usually in a several larval stages, allowing a single egg to develop into hundreds of potential adults. Okay? This is basically this is the reproduction is the most important characteristic of phylum Platyhelminthes, because there will be a well-developed reproductive system will observed in Platyhelminthes, because in order to survive they produce large amount of eggs. Okay, whereas there is a very like a poor excretory system or digestive tract. This is because they already get the digested food is available from the host, thus they have a very poor digestive system and the excretory system. Okay? But they will show a well developed reproductive system, a sense organ, a nervous system will be well developed in the Platyhelminthes in order to survive. So we will study about a typical life cycle of the trematoda. The first is adult release an egg. Egg is usually passes in the feces, must reach to the water to develop. So they require water to develop. Okay, then they forms a miracidium, that is a free swimming larva that penetrate tissue of the snail and transform into sporocyst. Sporocyst reproduces asexually, that is polyembryony. What is polyembryony? In a polyembryony is a larval stage that allows a single egg to develop into hundreds of potential adults. Okay, that is the polyembryony. It's more sporocyst. So sporocyst reproduce asexually by polyembryony, and that give rise to the number of sporocyst. Okay, this sporocyst or the converts into radia. Another stage, larval stage, is radia, also reproduces asexually and produces more radia and form a cercaria. This cercaria merge from the snail, penetrate second intermediate host or encyst in a vegetation to become metacercaria. Okay, then metacercaria, these are juvenile flukes. When eaten by a definitive host, develop into the adult fluke. Okay, some larval flukes are able to change host behavior to make them more likely to get a final host. Okay, so this is this complicated life cycle with the different larval forms. So once again we'll revise the life cycle of the trematoda. The adult release eggs into the feces, and this eggs are require water for the development. So under the favorable condition, this eggs gets convert into miracidium. This miracidium is a free swimming larva, and it get penetrate into host, that is the first host is the snail. Okay, and it transform into sporocyst. Sporocyst undergo asexual reproduction, that is by polyembryony. They form a multiple number of sporocyst, and this sporocyst get converts into radia. Radia is also divides asexually to form a number of radii. This radii get convert into cercaria, and cercaria emerge or leave the snail and penetrate into second intermediate host. Okay, where it become metacercaria. Metacercaria is a juvenile flux. It may remain in the that host, or it may leave that host and enters, penetrate into another host. Okay, this is the life cycle of the class Trematoda. Now we will we'll move to the class, last class, that is the class 3 Cystoda of Platyhelminthes. Cystoda means in a Greek Kistos means girdle and idos means form. So it is girdle form organism. Cystoda include tapeworm. Okay, so the body, they are all endoparasites, that are they are found on the oocytes inside the host body. Okay, they are most specialized class of the flatworms. All are endoparasites and can grow up to 10 meters. Okay, and adult can live up to 20 years. Okay, so body wall or body plan is they are very different from other classes of the flatworms, that is they don't have head. So there is no presence of head, but the front end of the animal is not a head, but there is a special organ called as a scolex will be present, that helps in the attachment of the parasite organism to the wall of the or lumen of the host. Okay, and it has a sucus or the hooks, sucus and the hooks, which also used in attachment, but not for the feeding or the sensing of the environment. Okay, this hook and the sucus are used only for the attachment. They have a the body is segmented, covered by the cuticle. Why cuticle? This cuticle helps the organism against the digestive enzyme of the host. Okay, then epidermis, cilia and the rhabdoids are absent. Okay, this presence of epidermis, cilia and the rhabdoids are important for the free living platyhelminthes, that is a class Turbellaria. Okay, so here there is no use of this. So they have a the body wall is covered by the cuticle. Okay, in order to protect from the digestive enzyme of the host. Then body consists of long chain of a reproductive sac called as a proglottids, and this proglottids bud off from the scolex. Okay, that is a bud from the scolex from the scolex will form a new proglottid. That is the new proglottid will be found near to the scolex, whereas the old proglottids will be placed far away from the scolex. Okay, this proglottid is not same as the segmentation, since each proglottid act as an individual animal. Okay, this body of the cystoda will resemble like a segmented, but this is not a segmentation, because this proglottid will be give rise to a new individual, fully developed new individual. And okay, or this proglottid act as an individual animal. Okay, and some individual can produce a dozens of proglottids per day. Okay, then the body wall, as I already said, that is the epidermis will be epidermis, cilia and the rhabdoids will be absent, but the tegument is sensual, not subdivided into separate cell. They will be microvilli will be present to increase the surface area for absorption. Okay, and tegument secreted by the protective cuticles. And they develop muscle layers beneath the body wall. Okay, then the feeding and digestion. They completely lack digestive system, because they get they are endoparasite. The radially digested food is available. Okay, so they absorb food through the skin. Okay, that is tegument. Okay, nervous system is simple. That is proglottid are united by a nerve cord, and there is no special sense organs will be present. Excretion is somewhat similar to other flatworms like protonephridia, continuous throughout the proglottid. Okay, so there will be protonephridia present on each proglottid. Okay, with the flame cell. Then the reproduction and the life cycle. Each proglotid act as an individual. Okay, so any two proglotid can exchange sperm. And it was studied that when a gravid, like a mature proglotid, contain lakhs of eggs, okay, up to in one proglotid. So life cycle of the cystoid is almost all tapeworms requires at least two hosts. Here the cystoid or tapeworms require at least two hosts, mainly vertebrates, but same host can bear either the adult or the larval parasite. Typically the intermediate host is the prey of the adult host, and all are monoecious, that is hermaphrodites. Okay, the most mature proglotids are those which are placed far away from the or furthest from the scrotum. Okay, and unlike most hermaphrodites, tapeworm proglotids can cross fertilize in a same animal. Okay, eggs or the mature proglotids are shed in a feces. Once the eggs is released, must be ingested by a intermediate host. So till that egg is remain in a cyst form, okay, which is encircled or capsulated. Okay, so under unfavorable condition also it is protected. And usually the vertebrate prey of the final host. Okay, once the eggs ingested, larva hatches and bores through the intestine of the host into the blood. So what happens when the eggs are released into the environment? They needs to get ingested by the host, that is vertebrate, and this host, when the egg is ingested into the or entered into the body of the host, the larva hatches, okay, from the egg, and that bore into the intestine of the host and enter into the blood system, blood or circulatory system. Okay, and that travels to the skeletal muscle, heart and other organ, and it secretes a protective cyst. In some, cysts develop into bladder worm or the cysticercus. Okay, and this in human they can get infected with the eggs by unsanitary habits, with the feces, not washing hands or kissing pads, etc. But humans makes poor intermediate host from the parasite perspective. But this doesn't mean that it cannot infect the human. It infect the humans also. Means humans can also be a host, intermediate host to the cystoid. Okay. So in this today's lecture, we have done the classification of the phylum Platyhelminthes with the brief general characteristics and their life cycle. Thank you.